Even though I miss the people that I love, it feels good coming home, yeah.
Good morning, Creekside. I'm Elijah. I'm filling in for Jalise this week. It's a pleasure to be worshiping with you guys this morning. I want to invite you to stand up, and we're going to start out this morning in worship.
To cry.
Begins as a whole with the idea of God breathing life into us, enlivening his creation. And this morning, it's my prayer, my hope for us that as we're gathering in this place today, that it's his life empowering you, that's motivating the words of your mouth to praise him, and that you will feel life. Life can be hard. You're weak. I don't know what you came in here with today, but God calls us to rest. This is a day of rest, and so let's sing together. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, His hands, His feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body bowed and drenched in tears, they laid Him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all God, we give You praise. Lord, and we thank You for the rest that You give. Lord, that Your work is completed, that Your Spirit empowers us, Lord, that we can rest in You. God, we pray this morning that as we look into of the road that you took on towards salvation for us. Lord, as we get into your word, I pray that you would give us understanding, Lord, that we would know, Lord, the depth of your love that we would receive it this morning, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
As you take a seat, can you guys give it up for the worship team this morning? Good morning, Creekside. My name is Nathan, and I'm one of the pastors here. And as you can already tell, if you look to your left and your right, service looks a little bit different today. First off, you might tell that there are a few ladies here without their husbands. That is because there's a men's retreat going on right now. But also, if you look to your left and your right, you might see some young ones in here. So I want to address all the kids in here. Welcome. We are so happy that you are here. It's great to have you. I know you're going to make some noise. That is okay. Parents, it's to be expected. This is a family service. It's okay. We love that the kids aren't in here. We love just being here as a family this morning. I just got back from men's retreat last night. I am exhausted, to be completely honest with you, because I was like, yes, Friday night, I get a night without my two kids that are under three. I get to sleep. At least that's what I thought. Because I had my brother-in-law's brother come to camp, and he showed up late. And then a young adult from our young adults ministry came to camp, and he didn't show up till 10:30, and they were bunking together. So, of course, I was like, I got to introduce them. And then I have to stay up and initiate conversation with them. And then I looked at the time, and I was like, wow, it's 12 o'clock. Okay, let's go to sleep. And then the beds are wonderful. It's a great sight. I just could not sleep. Needless to say, I hope I don't fall asleep up here, but the power of God will sustain me through this. But speaking of kids and speaking of men's retreat, there's something that happens when guys get to camp with other guys and we all act like children. But one thing that I love to do with my son Sam, who will be three in August, is to go on little hikes together. I love watching him and his creative side of just like stopping and like looking at everything, of picking up every single rock that he sees. And a mile might take us way too long to go the entire mile, but at least I'll be holding rocks and he'll be holding rocks. So whenever we see a body of water, that is the time to throw the rocks in. And this is something that he loves to do as one of his pastimes. We love hiking together. Yeah, we can pause and be like, oh, look at him. Little Sammy's grown up so quick. Yep, it's true. And, I mean, he just loves it. We'll find a body of water, and he'll pick up a rock, and he'll be like, oh, heavy, and then throw it in. Like, it is just something he enjoys doing. And I love it, too, because I like to see him just have so much fun watching the splashes, watching what floats, watching what sinks. But one thing that I like to do is I like to throw stuff into the water that floats because I like to watch how it goes down the river. I like to see where's the river going to pull it under and how often things that get pulled under actually come back to the surface and float again. And like I said already, these two photos, he loves it. Like, he will continue to throw rocks in over and over and over again for hours. It's one of his favorite pastimes, in my opinion. But I enjoy watching the stuff that floats. And one of the things in this season of my life that I've been really focusing on is surrendering to the love and will of God. And one of the reasons I like to watch what floats on the water is when you throw a stick in the water, the stick, it doesn't do anything. Like, it can't swim against the current. It just has to go with it. It has to go wherever the current takes it. And I think this can apply to all of us wherever we're at in our lives today. That, let's say the river is God's will and we are surrendering to it, it'll take us wherever God wants us to go. But it's in fighting against a current. It's in seeking our own way, our own will, our own pride, our own self, that we really set ourselves up for disaster when we hit rapids. Because if you exhaust yourself fighting the current, how are you going to survive the hard parts? But it's in surrendering to the current that you recognize that God can carry you even when you hit rapids, because there's the other side. And you just have to be willing to surrender to that. And in the scriptures we're going to look at today, we will see two different paths that are presented to us. One path that leads to life, and the other path that leads to a rebuke. Another path of seeking the things of humanity rather than the things of God. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me to Mark 8. And we're going to look at verses 31 through 38. Mark 8, 31 through 38. Says this, "And Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected by the elders and the chief priests and the scribes and be killed, and after 3 days rise again." Hint, hint, Easter. "And he said this plainly, and Peter, who was one of his disciples, took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and seeing his disciple, Jesus rebuked Peter and said, 'Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on things of man.' And calling the crowd to him with his disciples, he said to them, 'If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel will save it. For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul? For what can a man give in return for his soul? For whoever is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him will the Son of Man also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." Lord, as we dissect the scripture today, I pray, one, Lord, that you would give me your words. As we already sang, Spirit, come rest on us. Lord, I don't know everybody's individual story in here, but you do. We all have something that we are carrying with us, trying to fight with our own will. Lord, I pray that we would be willing to take up our cross, to follow you, to lay it down and say, I can't do this on my own. I surrender to the things of God. I pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. In the first section of scripture that we're going to look at, we see this theme play out in the rest of the verses we're going to look at. The very last thing that Jesus says, "For you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." We do this all the time in our lives, almost every single day. We want to understand what it means to follow God, but often we think that means what we want it to mean. We want to paint God in our image rather than painting ourselves in God's image. And even the disciples began to hear the path that Jesus would take. This is not the first time that he told them that the Son of Man would have to go and die. And they couldn't accept it. We see that happen. We see that Jesus and his disciples have this just exchange in these scriptures. And Jesus tells them again and again that he is going to die and be raised from the dead. And here are some important things that we must understand from this section of scripture, is that Jesus calls himself the Son of Man, a name that in that culture would refer back to Daniel 7. And in Daniel 7, 13 through 14, it states this, "I saw in the night visions, and behold, with the cloud of heaven, there came one like a son of man. And he came to the Ancient of Days and was present before him. And to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion, which shall not pass away, and his kingdom, one that shall not be destroyed. So when the disciples heard Jesus say, the Son of Man, this is the verse that they would have in mind. They would think of the Messiah coming down to establish a new kingdom, one that every single person, despite their language, despite their ethnicity, would be accepted in. This is what they had in mind. A God that would come down and establish a kingdom that was unlike anything else on earth. Why? Because it wasn't like a kingdom on earth. But in their mind, they saw this through a lens of what the world says about kingdoms. They saw this through the lens of things of man. They could not see that to establish the kingdom that Jesus was inviting them to, that he would have to die and then rise from the dead to show us that sin, guilt, and shame, they don't have the final say. And here, Jesus is saying it plainly. He's trying to tell them what is going to happen, and they still didn't understand. In fact, Peter, who is one of the most rambunctious of the disciples, is like, okay, nope, I can't accept this. I am going to take Jesus, the Son of God, aside, and I am going to rebuke him. First off, people really get on Peter, and they're like, really, Peter, why would you do that? Anybody else who has, like, a strong will, if you were in this situation, you would probably do the exact same thing. Let's be honest here. Peter, in his mind, thought that Jesus was going to create a new kingdom and establish a new way of living. And of course, Jesus did. But Peter didn't understand how. Peter only understood what he thought it should be. And Peter was basically telling Jesus that Jesus was wrong, and that this is not the way. Because Peter wanted to do this the way that he saw all kingdoms established at that time. A person comes, seeks power, gains influence, and takes over. Peter had his own will and the will of humanity in mind. He did not understand the things of God. And similar to how Jesus rebukes the wind and the waves in a storm, Jesus then rebukes Peter. Jesus does not hold back either. He says, get behind me, Satan. Which upon reading, some of us might be like, wow, Jesus, that's super rude. Like calling one of your followers Satan. But as I studied this section of scripture and as I read some commentaries on this, I found something pretty interesting in this, that in rebuking Peter, he was actually rebuking the temptations of the devil. That this was another attempt by the devil to pull Jesus away from the things of God. It was another attempt to stop Jesus from doing what he was called to do. So the rebuke is a reminder of how we can handle unwanted thoughts or temptations or fears. It's a reminder of how even sometimes when people come to us in love, they really don't have things of God on their mind. Sometimes they do. It's a reminder that when we fight temptations, we are called to rebuke them and seek the will of God. And Jesus continues to say to Peter, you are not setting your mind on things of God, but on things of man. Jesus does not justify what he said. He doesn't say, okay, Peter, like, sit down, let me explain to you why I have to go to the cross. No, he already did that. Instead, he rebukes him and says, where is your mind? What are you thinking about? What are you focusing on? Are you focusing on things of God? Or are you focusing on something else? So instead of justifying himself, Jesus affirms the will of God. And I believe this is super important to the day and age that we are in today, where we affirm things that people feel in any moment. We try to do things based on random thoughts that we have instead of surrendering our thoughts, surrendering our will, surrendering our self-image, surrendering our love life, surrendering everything to the will of God and recognizing that God created us in his image. Not in our image, but in his image. And it is in surrendering to the will of God that we begin to see why we are here. It's beginning this process of going, God, I might not know what direction to go right now, but all I know is I have to surrender to you. Show me your way. And it was upon saying this that Jesus then turned to the entire crowd and wanted to address them with the exact same thoughts. He wanted them to not follow the way of humanity. He wanted them to follow the way of God. And so Jesus, in verse 34, says this beautiful and powerful thing in two verses, and it continues after this, but let's just focus on these two verses, verses 34 and through 35. Jesus turns to the crowd and says, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake and the gospel's will save it. That is a powerful statement by Jesus. And as I said, at the beginning of verse 34, we see Jesus, he was just talking to the disciples for a second. And then upon rebuking Peter, he turns to the crowd and he wants to address them. Jesus sees everyone there and he calls them to the way of Jesus. And if we are followers of Jesus, we must deny ourselves, we must take up our crosses, and we must follow him. That is the only way to truly save our lives. It is in surrendering all that we are, every single part of us, to the will of God. It is surrendering to a banquet of God's will and God's love for us. To deny oneself is to say no to our own self-interests, pride, thoughts, insecurities, and fears. And instead, to say yes to Jesus. To say yes to a God that loves you and sees you and knows you. To say yes to loving God and loving others. Denying yourself sounds terrible, honestly, until you realize something. Until you realize that the God that created the entire universe, the God that created you, that knows you, that knows what you are doing, have done, and will do, that God is calling you to him. A God that loves you so much that he sent his son to die for you. When we consider the fact that God of the universe is asking us to deny ourselves, it should be easy for us to do it. Unless we have a wrong view of that God. But if the God that loves you, that has your best interest in mind, that is controlling the currents of the river, asks you to surrender to his will. Will you? Will you be willing to deny yourself, to say no to yourself, and instead say yes to God? And if you say yes to that, you have to be willing to pick up your cross. And this is one of the more interesting things in Scripture. When Jesus says this, he was basically telling the entire crowd that they have to take on the role of a criminal. Not in the sense that you're thinking, but more in the sense of you will be humiliated, but in taking on your cross, you are humbling yourself before the crowd, before everyone. But really, when you take on the cross, you are humbling yourself before God, saying, one, I can't do this on my own. Number two, God, I can't carry my own burdens on my own. I need your help. And Jesus is saying, pick up your cross, because he knows that your life, you will have suffering. Every single one of us in here, even though we live in a privileged area, has experienced suffering in some way or form. But Jesus saying this here, he's trying to address the fact that, guess what? I'm asking you to do something that I'm going to do myself. Jesus says, take up your cross, because Jesus was obedient to the point of death. Jesus was obedient to the point of death on a cross. And he calls us to do the same thing, to let go of our insecurities, to let go of our pride, to let go of our own paths and the way that we want to go. We're all clinging to something that we think gives us life. We're all clinging to something that we think is going to achieve our happiness. Maybe it's money. Maybe it's power. Maybe it's once we get this degree. Maybe, well, if we have more kids, we'll be happy. If we have this, well, if we have that. We're clinging to this idea that we'll be happy if we have blank, instead of recognizing that Jesus says, cling to the cross. Cling to the cross. The image of a man dying for our sake. Are we willing to die to ourselves for a God that looks at us and loves us and knows us in a way that's far better than we know ourselves? And then we see that Jesus calls them to follow him. Follow him. The path of Jesus, obedient to the point of death. Follow him. And he says this, in my opinion, because when God looks at us, he sees us through the lens of Jesus. And we are called to mirror Jesus. And each of us have different talents. Each of us have different ways of living, different things that we do. But Jesus is calling us to hand everything over to him and follow him. And we see that in doing this, in surrendering all that we are to his will. It is the path to save us. If we want to save our lives, we have to lose it. We have to let go of what we cling to that's going to bring us life and instead cling to the will of God. That is how we save our lives. It's not in fighting the current of the river. It's not in fighting anything. It's in laying it down and saying, God, I need you to carry me through this current. And I'm not saying that a river's current, even though I believe it's a great analogy for God's will, a great analogy for God's love. There are rapids in currents. There are hard points in currents. But when we hit those points, if we truly believe that God's love is with us, that God's will is with us and carrying us, we can still sit in it. We can believe that when we have a hard time breathing, God's going to get us to the other side, because it's his will, not our will. It's his way, not our way. And maybe some of you are chasing after your own way. And that's why Jesus, in the next section of Scripture, brings that up. He asks, what do you gain? What do you gain from doing all that? What do you gain from gaining the entire world, but you're forfeiting your soul? What do you gain from getting that promotion? What do you gain from any of it? Steve Sonchin at Men's Retreat brought up this subject of, if you had $30,000 more, would you be happy? Some people would be like, oh, heck yeah, I'd be happy. That's great. Until you get there. And then you'd be like, well, can I get $30,000 more? And you just go on this cycle over and over again. If you're focused on money, if you're focused on status, if you're focused on your toys. Toys break. I'm sorry to say that. What do we gain if we gain the entire world, but we forfeit our souls? It's this idea of kingdom mentality that doesn't focus on the here and now, but focuses on the future. It focuses on the fact that even if I'm caught in a rapid, I know there's going to be a lazy part of the river soon that I can relax in. So I'm going to trust the process. I'm going to surrender to the will of God and follow his way over my way. Because God's will is beautiful. And we see in this section of scripture that we're not meant to be ashamed of God. We're not meant to hide and be scared when people are like, "Are you a Christian?" We're meant to say yes, because God is love and he loves us. We do not need to fear that. We don't need to be afraid of it. But if we pursue our own will in the here and now, you may achieve everything you want, everything you ever dreamed of, everything that you think will bring you life, and yet at the end of your life, you can't take it with you. At the end of your life, what did you really gain? But in surrendering to the will of God, you know who God is, and God abides in you. There's only more and more and more if you chase after the things of the world. Only more and more that you'll want, more and more that you can achieve, more and more and more and more and more and more. But in God, it's surrendering. And I know that in surrendering, it might be hard for some of you. I know for me, I don't want to surrender. I want to take the hill. I want to be the person that throws everything on my back and is like, "No, I don't need any help. I got this." But in doing that, it leaves you broken and tired and exhausted. And I said this at an elders meeting not too long ago, that I wonder what it would look like to instead look at a hill and instead of say, "Take it," to sit there and pray and say, "God, I surrender this." What would it look like if we just sat there and literally prayed about all the things that we think are rapids, all the things that we think are hills in our lives? What would it look like if we stopped thinking of them as the way men think about them, as the way humanity thinks about them, and instead we started thinking about them the way that God thinks about them? A God that looks at you and sees a beloved child. It leads us to a choice of, will we surrender to the will of God or will we surrender to our own will? And if you're surrendering to your own will, how's that going for you? So the question is, will you surrender to God's will? And as I said, some of us have an idea of who God is, but we don't truly understand who God is. And at men's retreat, I had the blessing of giving the first talk, and I talked about how God is calling us to surrender to love. The men's retreat theme was love never fails, but in order to even begin to understand that love never fails, we have to understand what love is. And in 1 John 4:18, or 16 through 18, it says, God is love. God is love. And if this God that is love is calling you to him, will we continue to seek the way of humanity that seeks gain and selfish ambition? Or will we submit to a God that looks at you and loves you deeply? A God that created the entire universe, that asks you to surrender your will, to take up your cross, to follow him. This is a God that loves you so very much. And in this season of my life, I've been dealing with a lot of fears. A lot of fears. And at first I was like, just cling to what you know, Nathan. Cling to how you can fight it. Cling to all these things that you know you're supposed to do. And I had a mentor of mine say, "Why are you thinking so much about this? Just like surrender it." I was like, what the heck does that mean? Like, how am I supposed to just surrender these things? Like, do you not understand the implications of these fears? And I'm sure that's what Peter felt. Do you not understand the implications of what you're saying, Jesus? And Jesus' response to him was, what? Stop clinging to the things of man and cling to the things of God. We all have something in our lives that we have to surrender to God's will. It's not a will that is judging you or like throwing shame at you or guilt at you. No, instead, it's a will that loves you so much that even when you're in the rapids, he doesn't leave you there. This is the will of God, and he loves you. But you have to answer the question of, will you surrender to God's will? You are the only person that can answer that question. So whether that's a wrong view of God, whether that's you clinging to something that you think is going to give you life, you have to be willing to surrender it. You have to be willing to deny yourself and follow the way of Jesus, a path of surrender over and over again. Or as Mark Buving said a year ago, 1,000 little deaths daily to pursue one great life. So Lord, I pray that we would be a church that's willing to surrender to your will. Lord, I pray that we would be a church that is willing to see this call to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and to follow you as not something that is shameful or guilty, but instead as something that is a call to love. A call to recognize that our own way of living won't lead us to life. A call for us to see that when you look at us, you see us as beloved children. When you look at us, you say, what do you gain if you gain the whole world? Instead, surrender that and you gain Christ. Lord, I pray that all of us in this room, this week, today, that we would be led by the Spirit to surrender something. I pray that we would surrender to your will and not focus on the things of humanity, but instead that we would focus on the things of God. I pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Let's all stand together and continue to worship.
My hope is in
great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your love and kindness tore through the shadow of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped out from wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my dear.
Out of the
God, we thank you for today. We thank you that you are our hope and our rest. And Lord, we pray this week that as we walk out of here, Lord, that we would find our life in you, that we would rest in, Lord, the confidence that you give us what we need, that we, Lord, we can trust you. We love you. We thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Okay, you're so well behaved. You're all sitting down. I didn't even have to say it. Okay. You know the drill, right? Okay, here we are. Today was beautiful so far, and I have a couple things that I want to invite you to. As you, maybe most of you know, today is known as Palm Sunday, and this is where we celebrate the triumphant entry of Jesus into Jerusalem, and then that sets us up for the Holy Week. And this week, as a church, we have a couple of different things that we're offering just as a time to reflect throughout the week on what this looks like and what Jesus did for us. And this isn't up there yet, but I'm going to start with Stations of the Cross because it actually starts tonight. And so down the hall, I think it's room 202, Nathan? Yeah. 202, beginning this evening, between the times of 6 p.m. and 8 p.m., that room will be open, and we actually have the Stations of the Cross set up in there, not the actual Stations of the Cross, but to be able to reflect, and it's just a time of going in there, looking at the different steps that Jesus took this week, and just sitting in what that means for you. And it's a beautiful, beautiful experience, and so I encourage you to do that. It's going to be every night, from tonight till Friday night, when we have our Good Friday service, which is at 7 p.m., that will be in here. And that's just a time of really reflecting on Jesus' death. And then, of course, then we have Easter sunrise, Easter Sunday. We do have a sunrise service, but Easter Sunday when Jesus rose for us. And so Easter sunrise, we have at 6 a.m. It's going to be outside if the weather is good, in the event room if it is not. Beautiful, beautiful service. And then Easter Sunday, 9 and 10:45 a.m. are regular services. I do think there was something about kids on these. Was there, Nathan? Help me out. There you go. Thanks. Thanks for that. Just as this morning, like, kids, man, you guys were awesome in here this morning. Same thing for Thursday night. It's a kind of a somber thing, and Lisa has prepared some great things for our kids for that evening if you happen to bring your children. So I just want to leave you, not with all the announcements, because they're amazing, but just with, like, let's reflect back on what Nathan spoke about. And my heart is that I leave here more transformed, or that I can put something in shoe leather as I walk out the door. So I want to encourage you guys with that. And as Nathan was speaking, I was thinking of Paul's words in Colossians 3. And he says, since you have been raised to new life with Christ, set your sights on the realities of heaven, where Christ sits in the place of honor at God's right hand. Think about the things of heaven, not of the things of earth. For you died to this life, and your real life is hidden with Christ in God. So put on your new nature. And be renewed as you learn to know your Creator and become like Him. Since God chose you to be the holy people He loves, you must clothe yourself with tender mercy, with kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience, and make allowance for each other's faults. Forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. And above all, Clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are all called to live in peace and always be thankful. So that's what it means to deny ourselves. So go hit it this week, you guys. Love each other. All right.